body to sin might be destroyed, and we might no longer be enslaved to sin. For whoever has died is free from sin, but if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. The word of the Lord.
Back to this clapping. We will clap some more later. we talked about the first article of the Apostles' Creed, the first part of the Apostles' Creed, and we focused on God, the Creator. And we confessed that we believe in God, the Father, Almighty Creator of heaven and earth. And we talked about how that confession is also a statement of belief. We are confessing that God's presence is still here. God is still active and continually creating and making all things new. We're confessing that those around us, our neighbors, are made in God's image, and that impacts how we see them, how we treat them. Everyone is made in the image of God. We confess that God has deep love for creation, for all of creation. But how do we know about God's love? How do we know that we are loved? In our reading this morning, Paul writes in his letters to the Romans, saying, God proves his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. God proves his love. Literally, God composes or brings together and shows us his love. And this love comes in Christ on the cross. God's love is most evident, most clearly shown in Jesus Christ. So then the question becomes, well, who do we confess Jesus to be? Who is this Jesus? Well, luckily we have the second part of the Apostles' Creed. Let's read that together. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead.
There's a little bit more to this part than there was last week. But this, I think, highlights the importance that Jesus has in our faith. This is who we confess Christ to be. At its most basic, Jesus is the Son of God, born of the Virgin Mary, who came to earth, was crucified, had died, and was buried, was raised again on the third day, and is now seated at the right hand of the Father. This is who we confess Jesus to be. But, as we know, Martin Luther, in his Small Catechism, is not one to leave simple statements like this alone. He is one who wants to dig deeper into what does this mean? What does this mean? Let's read this together.
I believe that Jesus Christ, true God, begotten of the Father in eternity, and also true human being, born of the Virgin Mary, is my Lord. He has redeemed me, lost and condemned person. He has purchased and freed me from all sins, death, and from the power of the devil, not with gold or silver, but with his holy, precious blood, and with his innocent suffering and death. He has done all this in order that I may belong to him, live under him in his kingdom, and serve him in eternal righteousness, innocence, and blessedness, just as he is risen from the dead and lives and rules eternity. This is most certainly true.
This is a lot more to our confession. This digs deeper into our confession, and this is our faith. This is the ground cornerstone of our faith. This is important stuff. This is Jesus we're talking about. If we don't know what we confess about Jesus, we don't know necessarily why we should call ourselves Christians. We confess in the Apostles' Creed that Christ, the Son of God, has died for us, that we are redeemed creatures. We are claimed as children of God, united in Christ's death and resurrection. So I think by now, we've come to know, we've been told many times that Christ's death and resurrection is
good thing, but I want to challenge this and say maybe that it's something we still struggle with. Why is the death of somebody a good thing? Why is this good news? Why couldn't God just forgive people and not have Christ die? Why couldn't God just forgive people? Well, in short, he already did. God did forgive people because Jesus comes into the world and Jesus proclaims forgiveness. Jesus goes to the lowly, the outcasts of society, the tax collectors, the prostitutes, the sinners, those who weren't good enough, and proclaims forgiveness to them. And the leaders of this time can't stand this. They don't like this at all. How can somebody just go and tell people they're forgiven? It doesn't work that way. You see, in their minds, they pictured that in order to be forgiven, first of all, it is only God who can forgive sins. And second of all, in order to be forgiven, there has to be some kind of sacrifice. There has to be some kind of offering and a desire to turn away from that sin. You have to show that you are in some ways worthy of that forgiveness. And here comes Jesus, and he simply goes to people and says, "You're forgiven." Jesus heals them and says, "You're forgiven." Who is this Jesus that he can just come and tell people that they're forgiven? It shouldn't be that simple. Of course, in our confession, we confess that Jesus is not just another person. Jesus is the Son of God. And in our gospel today, John writes that Jesus says the Son can do all things that the Father can do. So if the Father, if God, can forgive sins, then so can the Son. So Jesus can forgive sins. But there still has to be a catch, right? There still has to be something that we have to do in order to earn this forgiveness, earn this grace. The leaders of Jesus' time expected this. They expected that there is something you have to do in order to be worthy of forgiveness of sins. And I think that this is something that we still struggle with today. We tell ourselves, "Gosh, I messed up. I just gotta try harder. I have to try harder." And we hear the words, "You are forgiven," and we say, "Yes, I know. But I still feel like I should do something in order to earn that forgiveness. I still feel like I have to make it up." We live in a state where we believe that we can still do something to earn or deserve God's grace, God's forgiveness. We can't. And this is what Luther's explanation is all about. Luther is emphasizing that this is a gift. It is not because of anything that we have done. It's because of what God has done in Christ. This forgiveness that Jesus comes proclaiming, this forgiveness runs so deep that even on the cross, Jesus says, "Father, forgive them." Even as Jesus is being put to death, he continues to proclaim forgiveness. It's almost as if we thought putting Christ to death could somehow allow us the opportunity to earn that forgiveness again. But as we know, 3 days later, Jesus is raised from the dead, almost as if to put the exclamation point on God's grace, saying, "You thought killing Christ would eliminate the gift, would eliminate the forgiveness that has already been given to you. Not even death can hold this forgiveness. This forgiveness runs so deep that life is bound to come from it. There's only life in this forgiveness." This is what we confess. He Each Sunday, we confess that we are forgiven creatures. We are beloved by God. And it's not because of anything that we've done. It's not because we've earned it or we deserve it. And it's not because we ever will earn it or deserve it. It's because that's who God is. A gracious and loving God who forgives. This is good news. This is why Jesus is good news. You remember how I told you we were going to be laughing?